Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.
Hello, welcome to Berks Perspectives. We're delighted to have you back again, and we're back again and ready to go with all sorts of stuff to talk about today. We may have a snowstorm this weekend, or maybe we won't have anything. It's remarkable how little clarity there is on these things anymore. But in any event, there's a lot of stuff happening that we want to talk about. Now, last week, if you recall, the panel requested that Professor John Forrester teach a class on filibusters. Filibusters are much in the news, and there's some uncertainty as to what exactly the whole thing is about. And John is going to give us, he promised it would be the Cliff Notes version, and there will not be a test. So, John, if you could lead off with that, and then we'll get into the recent news.
Okay. Oddly enough, the word filibuster comes from a bastardization of a combination of French, Spanish, and Dutch. And it refers to, it means freeboot. And it refers to the pirates in the Caribbean who were taking over ships and scuttling them and, what doing the pirates do.
Isn't that so appropriate? My God.
Yes. So the filibuster is meant to take over the debate. The Senate's supposed to be the deliberative body. It's supposed to slow things down so that we don't pass rash laws like the House does. And they're supposed to be more collegial and deliberative and polite than the House. At least that's how things were set up. Initially, it was created to give the minority, the filibuster was created to give the minority a chance to draw attention to its perspectives and to ensure that the bills would be fully debated by the full Senate. Of course, that's not the way it went. The way it came into being was by accident. It was in 1806, when Aaron Burr was vice president and presided over the Senate, they decided to redraw the Senate rules. And in doing so, they left out any proscription, any limit on the amount of debate a bill could have. So they just didn't think about it. And it allowed the senators to stand up and bloviate all they wanted as long as they wanted to. But the filibuster itself wasn't used till 1837, when it was used to stop the impeachment of Andrew Jackson.
Johnson.
So that was the first time it was used. Now to Jackson.
Johnson was after Lincoln, right? It was 1860.
Johnson was after Lincoln, right. He was impeached. It's not part of the Constitution. It's not mentioned at all in the Constitution. And the Constitution allows the Senate and to set up its own rules. This is, as it stands now, rule number 22. Let me see. It was very rarely used until the 1950s, actually. Prior to 1966, it was only used five times. And what it is, let's go to the procedure of a filibuster. It used to be a senator would stand up, and if he objected to, wanted to slow down or kill a bill, they would stand there and talk against the bill for hours upon hours upon hours.
Mr. Smith goes to Washington, right?
Mr. Smith goes to Washington. This is a great, great example of it. I think in that one they were giving, he was giving recipes for brownies or something. I mean, you know, he was just to keep holding the floor, keep talking. Actually, back in Roman times, I think I mentioned it was used to keep Julius Caesar out of Rome, so that he couldn't become a member of the Senate, or a censor, as they were called then. Strom Thurmond holds the record for speaking. He spoke for 24 hours and 18 minutes. In 1954. Mostly it was used to stop civil rights legislation. I'll get to the reasons for why each liberals and conservatives have used it in the past. Because, as it stands now, it cannot be used because of what they call the nuclear option. They cannot use it to block appointees of the cabinet level or the judges of the Supreme Court. It requires so most of the bills require 60 votes. Or three-fifths of the Senate, as it stands now. But appointments such as this can be, I'm boring you, can be used with a simple majority of 51 votes, which the Democrats now hold. Nuclear option has been used by both houses, by both parties, and it's at this point it's being used to block the Build Back Better program. It will require 60 votes.
When did it stop being a prolonged speech? When, you know, now somebody just says, I'm going to filibuster this, and when did that begin?
That's okay. That's started in 2017.
And so quite recently. Okay.
Yeah, and that was the Democrats, Harry Reid.
Reid. Yep.
Yeah, Harry Reid introduced that. And basically, they said any member of the Senate can initiate a filibuster. Now, the interesting part is that that's not on the record. There's no record that a filibuster is taking place. They just say, you know, this is a filibuster. They take it to the leader, and we're filibustering this bill. The only way you know that it's being done is when somebody files a motion for closure to end the filibuster, and that's made part of the Senate record. So that's how we know how many filibusters there have been as of late, because they've filed for closure. An end to the filibuster.
And that takes 60 votes to do that?
Yes, that takes 60 votes.
To end a filibuster, okay.
To end the filibuster. So that's where we stand now. They can stop just about anything, except with a few exceptions. We'll probably be talking about this later, but with the retirement of Justice Breyer, they're going to be bringing up a replacement nominee, and they won't be able to close to use the filibuster to block that nomination.
And that's as a result of Reed changing that rule, correct?
No, that goes back. It went by agreement. I think that was 2013, the year 2013 that they did that.
Isn't that one of the things that McConnell has done? Didn't he maneuver to get Supreme Court nominees, no, all judge nominees, to be confirmed with just a simple majority?
No, 2013, the Republicans held the Senate at that time. It was done by mutual agreement. And that's when we had mutual agreement in the legislature and in Congress. But that's where we stand with it now.
What troubles me both about the filibuster and the 60 vote requirement is this. I understand that the minority, how do I want to put this? We want to avoid having the minority trampled by the majority, that is silenced by them, and that's an important part. However, the way it is now, it seems to me that the minority prohibits the majority from doing anything. And so it is at a standstill. And so that's the tyranny of the minority to my eyes. I mean, and I don't know how you get a better balance. In Poland, when Poland was just being established as a nation, any one of the electors could veto anything that came before the parliament, which meant that a single person could stop any action from being happened, and it destroyed the country because every single person had the power of veto. It seems to me that this is not far from that. When you have the minority group allowing nothing to take place if they so desire.
Well, as I said in the beginning, it was designed to give the minority an opportunity to explain their side and to fully debate an issue.
Which I think is essential. I understand.
Right.
That.
But what we have today is no debate is allowed on these issues until the filibuster is lifted.
Right. And hundreds of bills won't even make it to the floor. They just, if it's the wish of the
majority leader,
or the speaker, if it's the wish of the head of the Senate.
Yeah, which is basically the floor leader, the minority, the majority leader.
Right.
John, why do some people believe that the filibuster is tied to the lack of civil rights, particularly for people of color?
Because that's when it was used as much. As I said, before 1966, it was only ever used five times. And most of those were for civil rights related bills.
To stop
in the 50s, yeah.
All right, well, John, thank you. Ruth, did you have another point, question?
Well, no. It'll come up. If I thought about it, it will come back. Maybe tomorrow.
Well,
I think the important thing I found out that we should consider is that this is basically kept secret. It's not a public act. It's not written down anywhere. It's unless there's a vote to force closure, to end the filibuster. But to start one, you don't have to. There's no evidence that one exists.
Are you seeing cloture? That's C-L-O-T-U-R-E.
Yes.
Okay. And so when somebody like Kristen Sinema or Senator Manchin says that they are standing by the filibuster and don't want to see changes, and link that to the Constitution, that's erroneous, right? Because it's not the Constitution.
That is, you're correct. It's not mentioned in the Constitution at all.
Now, these are just the rules of the Senate.
This is Rule 22.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, thank you, John. That was helpful.
Thank you.
We appreciate that very much. Now,
I hope it didn't bore you.
No.
There are a whole lot of things for us to talk about. I'd like to start out, though, with a couple of fairly local sorts of things. A lot of news just this morning and yesterday, I guess, in regards to the Reading Public Museum. There's been some controversy. There's been talk of actually moving the collection to another facility somewhere else in the county. Now Judge Madeline Fudeman has issued a ruling that it must stay where it is, including the things that are so-called in storage. They were going to move to another spot. And that was largely because they have flooding issues and there's damage that sometimes has occurred. But now they can't even leave the building, let alone move the collection that people can go and view. Her ruling says that students of the Reading School District and their parents or guardians, whatever, must be given admission and for free. That it is a partnership with the Reading School District and is now being formally viewed as part of the curriculum, or I guess this might be the best way to put it. So it's staying put. That is not well received by the foundation that operates the museum, but they don't really have any choice. So whether this goes to appeals or anything else will remain to be seen. But panel, what do you think about that ruling? For once, I'm going to kind of lead off. I think it's absolutely correct that it should stay where it is and not be moved around because of some disagreement between a bunch of adults that don't communicate well with each other. So I'm happy to see it stay where it is. I think that's where it belongs.
Mark this down.
There's got to be something they can do about, controlling flooding better or something. So. Panel, what do you think?
I'm going to agree with you. Mark that down, Fred. I totally agree with you.
Well, it was inevitable.
January 27th.
It seems to me to be a power struggle between some people who have gotten, who think they have done a very good thing, which they have, but it may not give them as much rights to decide what happened to the museum as they think it should. It seems that their motives were not quite as honorable as we thought they were.
You're talking about the foundation.
I'm talking about the foundation. And I'm sure if you're watching this and you're part of the foundation, you're now condemning me, but it's just how I see things. The museum has been there and is truly a high spot, a high point of our county and what it has to offer. And I can't imagine it being moved anywhere else. And as for the Reading children and their parents, it was started by Levi Mengel, who was in fact a science teacher in Reading. And that's what it was originally begun as.
That's right. The one thing I might argue about, though, Martha, is I'd like to see it accessible to every high school or grade school, whatever student in the county. I mean, the fact that you're in a one of other districts. I mean, I don't think that should limit, you know, not every family has got the means to go spend money for admissions and this and that. I don't know that the parents have to be let in for free, but I think the kids should be.
I would tend to agree with that. Absolutely.
Let me, I was a member of the board for 6 years and a part of that foundation group.
Oh, sorry.
No, not at all. But I want to explain things. You know, the way that it's put together now is really an unhelpful setup. And and I don't know what can be changed about it, but let me just explain it from the foundation's point. The Reading School District owns the buildings and owns the collection. They contribute $0 toward it, which means that the foundation then is faced with coming up with the bucks to do everything that is required. When there's a flood, to pay for all of the damage that's done. I mean, of course, they have insurance, but you know, when there are building issues that need, when trees come down, conserving the artworks that are there. So all of that is the responsibility of the foundation. And so here's the problem. They have somebody that's come and they're willing to give X dollars for the building. You know, we have had people approaching, you know, even offering to build an additional wing onto the building, except they're offering it to the foundation who's going after the money, and the foundation doesn't own the building. So they're being asked to contribute money to a group that doesn't own a building, doesn't own the collection, you know, and so they don't do it. So, I mean, it really, the foundation is caught between a rock and a hard place, I think, because they're given this enormous responsibility and are not, and to Fred's point, it would be nice to invite every student in the county in, but that's a tremendous source of income. And it sounds very nice. Let's have the largesse to allow every student from the county in, but who's gonna pick up the tab? And it's the responsibility of the foundation to see that the finances are in good order and that everything that needs to be done is done. So, I mean, that's the problem.
And Fred, to your point, the museum's collection itself is not monolithic. This is not a monolith. This is not the first time there's been controversy. And I covered some of the controversy when they were trying to sell off some of the more valuable pieces
school
years
boards,
ago.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. And the exhibits themselves need constant care. We saw the Mengel's butterfly collection, which is one of the most extensive in the world. It's deteriorating. It was being attacked, I think, by mites or something like that years ago, and needed extensive work to save it. The paintings are loaned out at times. I've been to the storage areas in the museum, and they're pretty junked up. I mean, it looks like Fibber McGee's closet. There are priceless and valuable and educational exhibits there that are not on exhibit, because there's no way to properly present them. There's no space to properly present them. And so they are loaned out to at points to other museums. There's an exchange program between the museums, which keeps our museum's exhibits fresh. And, we've all been over to see the mummy and the shrunken heads, but, you know, there are plenty of educational items over there that really need need to be shared and seen by people. And unless you have somebody curating the exhibits themselves, the collection itself, and have fund that effort, you're just going to have a monolith that nobody's going to be interested in.
And if it's so onerous, why did the foundation agree to it? I mean, those were the terms that were agreed upon, what, in 1991, I think? And there are three entities, right? There's the school district that owns the buildings and grounds.
And collection.
No, the collection is not owned by the school district. It's owned by a group of board members.
Boy, I wasn't aware of that.
Yes, there's a museum committee.
Yeah, there's a museum committee made up of school board members, Reading school board members, and then the foundation. So it's really a three-headed organization. But I'm not quite sure why, if it's become so onerous, that the foundation would have agreed to it.
I can't answer from then. I can answer only from now. You know, the school district has pride of ownership, and the foundation has the yeoman's task of caring for it all. And as I say, without money of support from the school district. And as the building ages, as climate changes make for all of the problems with the Arboretum and the flooding and everything else, the foundation is saddled with an enormous task. And the building, I love the museum, I love the building, but it is inadequate in many ways. And it's not easy to figure out how the bills are going to be taken care of.
Well, one thing for us all to bear in mind is, from my understanding, that is one of the finest museum collections for a city of our size anywhere in the country. It is an absolutely first-rate thing that any big city would be delighted to have. And we end up thinking about it as a place to go feed the ducks or something like that. It's a shame.
I think too, Fred,
the ducks are gone.
Supposedly, when Mengel set up the idea of the museum, he didn't really include artwork in it. His was a plan to have hands-on exhibits for kids to spark their interest in history and science. And so kind of the art collection, grew beyond what he ever expected the collection to be. I also have heard that the foundation makes some of their decisions and assumptions because of the financial problems of the district in the past. But for at least 7 or 8 years, the district has been at least stable. But all of this too leads to the ongoing lawsuit that's being heard between several school districts and the Pennsylvania legislature, and how school districts are funded. So it's not as though there's one thing. There are a lot of things that are tied together that lead us to a lot of the places where we are.
I believe the state donates some funding to the museum. I recall seeing it past budgets. Not much. This is a problem. This is a problem that has been existed and is being exacerbated as time goes on. And I think Judge Feudeman's decision was probably a short-term stopgap to end a squabble rather than to solve a problem.
I guess I don't quite understand why, if I had $50,000 and wanted to give it to the museum to ensure that it was upgraded and made safe for the collection, et cetera, why I wouldn't do it because I'm giving it to the foundation. So what?
Because you can't give it to the school district.
Yeah, the foundation doesn't own the stuff, and therefore the board, whomever they actually are, could take the stuff and tell the foundation, you're out of here. So you can't give the money to somebody and then now they can't use it.
The
money couldn't be given to the foundation and used for building maintenance or groundskeeping or whatever? Is that because of that division? Because they don't own the building? That money couldn't be used, couldn't be applied to maintenance? Well,
it's my understanding that that's the dilemma. The school district is not, the school district owns everything. The foundation is given the job of caretaker. And they're two different entities. It's made for a difficult time, that's for sure.
Yeah, I understand why if I have money and I want to see that the museum is kept safe and where it is, I can't donate that money to the foundation to be used to do what you said is the job of the foundation. What am I missing?
Exactly.
You can.
We have in the past occasionally, as we all know, had guests join us as experts in some particular subject. I don't even know who to ask, but it seems to me like we ought to have somebody that has something on the inside of this thing to come and answer some of those things.
Well, maybe Judge would come and tell us why she made the decision she did.
I don't know if judges can do that, but I don't know.
Yes, she can. She should have spelled it out in her ruling.
I don't know whether John Smith would be willing to come and talk about this.
You can't have him without having somebody from
It has to be somebody more objective that we could ask questions of and get an objective answer rather than one that was from the museum.
As I recall, you're going to need three people coming from three perspectives, and you're gonna end up with
it may be too hot to handle.
Right.
Yeah. This is a real quagmire.
And it's something, a topic really important for people to understand. So I don't know who you could get or how, and maybe we're not the forum for this to happen. But not long ago, there was the foundation put something on Facebook to have people sign a petition. But it was so vaguely worded that people didn't sign because they didn't know what they were signing. So I think not everything is above board and it's not black and white. I think there are all kinds of shades of gray. But you've touched on something really important that the community needs to know about.
Yeah, it's a shame we don't have a local newspaper that could dig into these things, but
indeed.
I'm being facetious again, but I think in many regards in the big picture view, this is just kind of points out something that John, I know you and I have talked about occasionally well thought out adult beverages that we suffer around here from this lack of leadership. That I've often described leadership as the ability to connect the dots, and there just doesn't seem to be anybody that's connecting the dots and sees, look, we got to get these people to bang a couple of heads together and come up with something here, and it just doesn't happen. I mean, our much of our past business that has slowly but surely dissipated have reached the point of taking the concept of unenlightened self-interest to the level of an art form, for God's sakes, and nobody looks at this kind of stuff of what an asset that is and how it ought to be something that we would fight like the Dickens to preserve and enhance. And instead we get into these, you know, mud baths. It's very troubling. But however, that sounds like a subject for another day.
Well, one of the things is the lack of a newspaper, the lack of a vibrant newspaper that is creating a sense of community. We don't have, we're losing our sense of community.
Yeah.
Because of
it. Yeah. And the community feeling that it seems to me that it must be creating is contentious. It publishes, for instance, the school board minutes from school boards that are having a rather large battle. And people reading that now pick a side. It's just dividing us. For the articles that are in now just further divide us.
Well, I mentioned that there were two local subjects I wanted to touch on before we got into some national stuff. The other one, which segues rather appropriately off of this, is the ongoing argument about redistricting that is upon us here. According to this morning's news, there are like a dozen competing congressional maps that are going to end up in the court system to figure out which one they're going to use and so on. But increasingly, we here in Berks County seem to be viewed as part of a mathematical mix of how many people get added to what particular district. And again, there's no leadership in that. We first of all ought to be in one, the county in one district, but nevertheless, we get into this stuff and there's just no leadership to pulling it out. So now we're looking at these competing maps, which are, I know, knowing the way the court system works and then the possibilities of appeals, I think it's almost inevitable that the May primary is going to end up getting delayed. I don't know what you might think of that, John, but let's chat for a moment or two about this redistricting dilemma and then move into the national stuff.
Redistricting is done, first of all, it's suggested from Washington. The suggestion comes from Washington, from the incumbents themselves. And we have in the House of Representatives, we have, I believe, an equal number of Democrats and Republicans.
In the Pennsylvania delegation, you mean?
Yeah.
It's seven. What is it? There's 17 districts, so it can't be even. I think it's like 9 and 8 or something.
It would be something like that. It's relatively even.
Yeah.
So you're gonna have to have that amount, that ratio.
But we're losing one district, so that will make it even, I guess.
Yeah. Right. Then it goes to the legislature, which is Republican. And the Republicans are going to want to draw the maps the way it favors them. And then it goes to when the Democrats object, it goes to the Commonwealth Court, which is, in my experience, relatively nonpartisan and pretty fair. And then it goes to the Supreme Court, which can be political. So I agree with you wholeheartedly. I think the elections should be delayed until these maps are settled. It's not going to be easy. You're going to have lawsuits all over the place, and Commonwealth Court's going to have to take care of it. And this is ultimately the Supreme Court.
The other thing that we're seeing more evidence of constantly, and this is, I think, being added to that mix, is the concept of making a Pennsylvania Constitution amendment to settle how these things are done so that you don't have it subject to, in this case, currently a Democrat governor's veto.
Um,
That one left us speechless, but.
That's going to take. I'm not sure that that wouldn't take a constitutional convention.
No. Wow.
The last one we had was in 1968.
Yeah. Even more complicated. Ruth?
Is everybody so afraid that their opinions are so weak that if they had a debate with somebody who was of the opposing party, or maybe six people from six parties, are we so insecure that people need to draw maps before elections to make sure they're going to win the election instead of using their ideas and policies and common sense through debate and such to win an election? I know you guys always say it's the way it's done, it's part of the process, it's going to be that way, but can't we change the way we redistrict and just do it in a way that makes sense and forget political parties?
Not under the current political atmosphere, no.
But, okay, so put that to the side. I just think that it's so ridiculous that our future depends on politicians drawing maps that will make them continue to be representative of the people, even though they often don't represent the people after they get in office.
I go back to my favorite quote. The truth is what is. What should be is a lie.
Yeah. And never forget the first rule of politics, which is self-preservation. So.
Well, that should be thrown out with the baby and the bathwater.
Well, I wouldn't hold my breath on that. Well, why not? All right, we're beginning to wind down on time here. This has been such fun.
I was just going to ask, aren't there some states that are working with nonpartisan groups to redraw maps? I mean, at least I've read about it. I don't know how effective it is or, you know, I have read about that, and I would think that it's possible here. Does it need to be partisan?
Nominally, we have that.
And that's at what level, or what? Which of these 12 maps would represent that?
I'm not sure, but there's a committee of Democrat, equal Democrat, and Republican leader.
Right, and that was Mark Nordenberg's group, right? I mean, he was the chair of that group. Yeah, and that's so. I don't know where all of these other diverse maps are coming from. But, I would think that it could be done by people of good faith.
Yes.
Looking to say, what's the most equitable way of doing with this? I mean, it is enormously complex. There's no doubt about it. You've got population shifts and which counties get divided up, which counties remain whole. I don't think I'd want to be a part of that, but surely somebody or some computer program or some combination of things could do it in a way that isn't just geared to having representatives electing their voters, which is the way it's been when it's at its worst.
But it seems to go back to the same problem that we've had with talking about the museum. There's no leadership. There is no one who has come forth and able to lead it in a neutral way and get all three sides in the case of the museum to work together to find out. And this is the same thing. We now have 18 districts. We're going to move to 17. So there will be an odd number. But it seems to me that the same problem is occurring here. You just described what Fred described as the problem with the museum.
Well, to be continued, because I would like to get to a couple other things, but part of fitting in nicely with what we've been talking about, and John referred to it during his filibuster remarks, yesterday it was announced that one of the justices of our current crop of Supreme Court folks has decided to step down. Justice Breyer is going to be retiring. He's considered to be a reliable liberal sort of vote as opposed to the more conservative types that have been appointed in recent years. And obviously this is important to President Biden, who would want to have the opportunity to replace him with another liberal-sided thinking justice. And here we go. There are some reports that Justice Breyer was surprised by the announcement that he was retiring. I mean, he had announced that he was going to probably at the end of his term do something, but I think it's unprecedented for someone, in this case the White House, announced that he was leaving rather than the justice himself, which is seems like bad form to me. But nevertheless, I don't want to take a chance of him changing his mind or something. But
sorry, Fred, that was leaked. That was leaked yesterday by a news organization, and the White House did not comment on it until today.
Well, I didn't hear whatever they said about it today, but nevertheless, what do we think? You know, how's this going to turn out? The president has, during his campaign for the presidency, announced that he was going to be anxious to appoint a woman of color to the Supreme Court. So is that the direction this is going to go? And then who might that be? I don't know much about some of the names I've heard kicked around, but I have heard of Vice President Harris's name being put in the mix.
Not in the mix.
That is
something that was put from I've been watching all the news stations, including Fox and listening to the right wing stations, and they are putting that out. Biden needs her in the Senate, presiding over the Senate, to cast the 51st vote. So, I mean, she's not going to be included. They're floating, I believe, five names, all black women, all with relatively good credentials. The Republicans are angered that Biden has painted himself into a corner by promising a black woman, and thereby eliminating, you know, 99% of the qualified lawyers.
But it looks like Trump picked people who were going to, he was told would reliably get rid of Roe v. Wade, but we shouldn't be upset by that. Hey, John, may I ask a question? Because I know I don't know and I didn't do my research. Can a sitting Supreme Court justice be impeached?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, well, how can I go about starting the process?
I don't know. Contact the John Birch Society, because back in the 60s, they were trying to impeach Earl Warren.
Yes, I remember that.
Yeah. Now, does anybody else have, is it concerning to anybody else that Clarence Thomas voted?
Yes, wife.
Yes,
yes.
Is like actively trying to get people arrested who are,
yes.
The January 6th committee in the House. She has demanded that they be, censured or gotten rid of. And he's the only justice who voted to protect Trump's right to keep his documentation.
Indeed.
That was an 8-1 vote. And listen, I don't put a whole lot of faith in these labels of liberal or conservative justices. Once they put those robes on, they're on for life if they want to die in office, and nobody can hold them accountable. They are their own. They are laws unto themselves, and they are ruled. They are pretty assiduous in trying to stick to the rule of law and precedent.
But
I don't see that with Thomas.
But that's also, that's really what Judge Breyer said after he was put onto the court, that he doesn't consider himself, he didn't want to be considered a liberal, but he said pretty much what John just said, that once you're on the court, you lose that political. I have to agree with you. I don't think Clarence has lost it at all. He's hardly spoken up in the first 1,000 years he was on the court, and now he's starting to ask questions. I thought it was kind of interesting. I'm sure his wife is. Oh, I just am not going to say that.
This is a topic for another day, but I really wish we did not have lifetime appointments to the Supreme.
Indeed.
I think a 10-year term is plenty of time to make your mark, to do your work. And this gives far too much power to too few for too long.
And one of the three branches of government, remember.
John, one of the criticisms of the court is that, unlike the other three branches, they don't have a whole lot of rules and regs that keep them from some indulgences that maybe the other branches don't, like money and who can donate and what those donations imply.
And what influence that can buy, exactly.
What are the ethics? Are there formal ethics that the Supreme Court is supposed to follow? I'm sure there must.
Yes, and they're subject to censure by the other justices.
Well, the implication is that they are much less stringently controlled than the other branches.
And they should be. I mean, they shouldn't be stringently controlled. There's the rule of law, and there is legal precedent. There is a history of legal precedent and rulings in the past, and they have to pretty much walk that line.
After the Texas abortion law was upheld by them, that rule of law has been almost, this is the 49th year since Roe versus Wade, and I don't see that precedent is going to be followed by this particular court.
In spite of their promises during their hearings. Yeah.
Okay, I don't want to get into this, but Roe versus Wade has not been codified. It's not the law of the land. It is a precedent. They were ruling on their ruling was along a state's rights issue. Does the state have the right to limit abortions? And they rule that they do.
Well, now we're really getting down to the wire here. We ought to at least take a moment on the current status of our COVID pandemic. Any thoughts there on, it seems to be a matter of the Omicron thing beginning to fade a bit. Hospitalizations are down, I believe. They seem to have been somewhat, if not a lot, less severe. And I asked the question when I sent out the agenda, do we think that perhaps the whole pandemic is beginning to reach a point where it's something we have to accept that we live with and we try to control it with therapeutics and so on, or will it continue to be viewed as a crisis of the sort that we've had since 2020?
There's a new
strain. Still creating a crisis in the hospitals that are running, that have no beds, and that they had to decide who gets that one bed. And I have to say that personally, it hit me this week because a very dear friend of mine died of COVID complications, went to the hospital for some other situation, was not a healthy man and rather elderly, but he contracted COVID while he was in the hospital and died of complications of COVID. And that's, it was a shock to all of us who knew and loved him.
And Fred, quite recently, they've discovered yet another variant of Omicron that showed up, I think, across the country. And nobody really knows how different, more severe, less severe. It is something that I think John has said this in the past. It has that ability to get you because that's its job. Its job is to try to find ways to bypass things that we can use to control it. And Regeneron, remember that? Well, it was being used to treat the disease. Right. It didn't work against Omicron.
Right.
And there was, an Eli Lilly medication that was used to treat it is also ineffective when it comes to Omicron.
Yeah, they worked on Delta, but they didn't work on Omicron. You're correct about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but I understand there's a new one that does work on Omicron or something, but that one of those same manufacturers has. John?
The fact of the matter is that this is something very new, something we know relatively little about. We're learning a lot every day. Science is working at the speed of light, it seems. And I think we ought to really trust the scientists. Stop listening. I am so sick of listening to CNN, Fox, and all the news stations reporting on this, and just follow the science on it.
That the public seems to be saying enough's enough or whatever. You know,
I'm sick of wearing a mask.
One of the most recent things I read, John, indicates that of the people that have had the initial two doses, only about 40% of Americans have actually had the booster, and they are readily available. Now, that level of indifference, or whatever you want to call it, I don't know. How do you explain that?
Because there's a resistance to it,
I think it's
political resistance.
It is not paying attention to science. And I think that's because it has become politicized. I agree with John. We need to listen to what the science is saying. I don't think we can look too far down the road. Because this virus is full of surprises.
Yeah. And, but there's so many mixed messages. I mean, the courts have struck down the federal mandate that all companies over 100 people have to, tell you you're fired if you don't get the shots, the vaccine. There's a lot of people that seem to be saying enough's enough. John?
It's a political overreach. I agree. But as an individual, as a non-political individual, I don't want to get it. I want to live and die of whatever I'm going to die of, but not this a new virus. And I'm going to do everything I can to protect myself.
I think the worst thing that we can say is we're tired of this. And we're going to go back to normal, or we're going to turn off the television, ignore what science is telling us. I mean, that apathy is the death, will be the death of us. We have got to be vigilant and take this seriously.
Well, gang, we are out of time. And I thank you for your thoughts and comments today. Obviously, all of these subjects are going to be ongoing parts of our weekly get-togethers. And the panel's advice is get vaccinated and boosted. But whether people do, I get it, that people
are all in agreement.
And there does seem to be an enormous implication of other underlying problems that, you know, are forcing the people. Martha, you said that your friend, and please accept our condolences, had other stuff. I mean, it's horrible that it was then contacted in the darn hospital itself. But we must leave. So thank you for joining us, audience. Can't wait to see you next week. Have a great week, and please stay well. Goodbye.
Wear a mask.
Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.